The River Jordan was at flood stage. It was a wide, raging river. The Israelites had been waiting for 40 years for the day when they would finally cross over this river into the Promised Land. They were amassed on the east side of the Jordan. And across this raging river, on the west side, they could see the Promised Land before them. Purify yourselves, Joshua tells the people, for tomorrow the Lord will do a great miracle. The next morning, as God had instructed, the priests took up the Ark of God to lead the way forward. They went up to the river's edge, and they stopped. The story continues from Joshua chapter 3, verse 14.
So when the people broke camp to cross the Jordan, the priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant went ahead of them. Now the Jordan is at flood stage all during harvest. Yet, as soon as the priests who carried the Ark reached the Jordan and their feet touched the water's edge, the water from upstream stopped flowing. It piled up in a heap a great distance away at a town called Adam in the vicinity of Zarethan, while the water flowing down to the Sea of the Arabah, that is the Dead Sea, was completely cut off.
Sir Colin Humphreys is the current director of research at Cambridge University. In 2003, he published a book on the miracles of Exodus from a scientist's perspective. He also gave a lecture a year later at Trinity College, Cambridge. He noted in this lecture how precisely the account in Joshua gives the geographical details of what happened and identifies where the water stopped. The water didn't rise up in a big heap right there where the Israelites were ready to cross the river. Instead, the water was stopped far upstream at a place called Adam, in the vicinity of Zarethan. Now, many scholars agree that the ancient city of Adam is what is now called Damia. Sir Humphreys goes on to note how on the 11th of July, 1927, an earthquake measuring 6.5 on the Richter scale occurred along what is known as the Jericho Fault, runs north to south along the River Jordan. Now, during this earthquake, mudslides occurred near Damia. Damia, which was again the ancient city of Adam, is about 30 kilometers or 18 miles north of Jericho. These mudslides temporarily stopped the river's flow. Amos Ner, professor of geophysics at Stanford University, has said this. He said, such cutoffs, lasting typically 1 to 2 days, have also been recorded in 1906, 1834, and he gives a list of dates when this has happened. And he continues, he says, the stoppage of the Jordan is so typical of earthquakes in this region that little doubt can be left of the reality of such events in Joshua's time. Writing about the events surrounding the exodus of God's people out of slavery in Egypt into the Promised Land, the psalmist in Psalm 77 writes this. You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the peoples. With your mighty arm, you redeemed your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph. The waters saw you, God. The waters saw you and writhed. The very depths were convulsed. The clouds poured down water. The heavens resounded with thunder. Your arrows flashed back and forth. Your thunder was heard in the whirlwind. Your lightning lit up the world. The earth trembled and quaked. Your path led through the sea, your way through the mighty waters, and though your footprints were not seen, you led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Natural events, including earthquakes, are all part of God's creation, and in his hands can become the means for demonstrating his miraculous power. Now, there will be those who dismiss this miracle recorded in Joshua 3 as nothing more than a coincidental occurrence of an earthquake causing a mudslide which stopped the river upstream. I'm reminded of a story told by postmodern writer David Foster Wallace.
There are these two guys sitting together in a bar in the remote Alaskan wilderness. One of the guys is religious, the other's an atheist, and the two are arguing about the existence of God with that special intensity that comes after about the fourth beer. And the atheist says, "Look, it's not like I don't have actual reasons for not believing in God. It's not like I haven't ever experimented with the whole God and prayer thing. Just last month, I got caught away from camp in that terrible blizzard, and I was totally lost, and I couldn't see a thing, and it was 50 below. And so I tried it. I fell to my knees in the snow and cried out, 'Oh God, if there is a God, I'm lost in this blizzard, and I'm going to die if you don't help me.'" And now, in the bar, the religious guy looks at the atheist all puzzled. "Well, then you must believe now," he says. "After all, here you are, alive." The atheist just rolls his eyes. "No, man, all that was a couple Eskimos happened to come wandering by and they showed me the way back to camp."
Sir Humphreys argues that this miraculous drying up of the River Jordan was indeed nothing less than a miracle. It was, as he puts it, a miracle of timing in which no natural laws were broken. God can work through the forces of nature, and he does. God can work through people, and he does. Yes, even through you and me to make miracles happen. A few days ago, I was having a late afternoon snack at Dan Ryan's with Steve Weibel. And Steve, we're praying that your back gets back in shape. And as I was sharing with Steve about today's sermon on the miraculous crossing over the Jordan, Steve leaned over to me and he said, "What triggered it?" With that intensity that Steve can ask the question. I said, "You mean what triggered the drying up of the river so they could cross it?" And again, he repeated, "Yes, what triggered it?" I said, "Well, when the priest's feet touched the water's edge," hoping I got the right answer. And with a big smile, Steve punches the air and he says, "Exactly. It's all about obedience." God told them to carry the ark until their feet touched the water's edge. That's when the miracle happened. Do you need a miracle in your life? Are you willing to step out in faith and let your feet touch the river's edge? Are you willing to take that step of faith and believe Jesus when he says, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, the door will be open." Eric Metaxas is probably best known for his biography of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. But he's also written another book, and it's simply called Miracles. In his book on miracles, he not only talks about what are miracles, but he also includes several chapters illustrating examples of modern-day miracles. One chapter is entitled The Beggar in Ghana. And he starts off the chapter by mentioning that he heard about this miracle in a sermon that was delivered on the 6th of October, 2013, at a church in New York City. Well, you can imagine my surprise as I keep reading to find that what he says is that the sermon was preached by Pastor Doug Webster. Doug is my older brother. Doug teaches at Beeson Divinity School, and that's in Birmingham, Alabama. And for several years, he helped pastor Central Presbyterian in New York City. He also has been involved with this ministry in northern Ghana in Africa. This ministry includes the building up of an agricultural development, getting heavy equipment and bulldozers into the country. After a long process of prayer, planning, and fundraising, the equipment finally arrived, and it got through customs, and was ready to be put to work. Everyone in the ministry was thrilled. But then something happened to eclipse their excitement. The chief driver for the ministry is a man named Simon. He has been suffering from diabetes for several years. 2 months earlier, he had begun to develop a sore on his left foot. Over those 2 months, his left foot deteriorated, and the doctors told him it would have to be amputated. Now, for Simon, this was especially devastating news. It was his left foot, and for a driver, that's his clutch foot. Losing that foot would mean losing his livelihood. He wouldn't be able to drive anymore. And he told his wife that his driving days were over, and they wondered what they were going to do. Simon decided to go to a prayer service that was held in a gazebo in a nearby village where the staff of this ministry gathered every morning to pray. They prayed for Simon's foot, and he felt nothing in particular when they prayed. But later that same day, he stopped to fill up his truck with gasoline at a fuel station. And while he was pumping gas into the truck, a man who looked like a beggar approached him. Simon instinctively reached into his pocket to take out some coins to give to the beggar. But the beggar said he didn't want any money. The man said he noticed that Simon was limping. And he said, "Can he pray for Simon?" Simon said, "Yes." And the man took out a vial of oil, anointed his leg and his foot, and prayed for Simon. After Simon finished fueling his truck, he tried to find the man, but the man was nowhere to be found. He looked everywhere, but it seemed the man had just up and vanished. It all seemed very strange. When he returned home, his foot suddenly felt very warm. It seemed that something was happening. Over the next few hours, he could see the coloration change before his eyes. His legs and his foot were completely healed. Miraculously healed. When Simon went back to the doctor told Simon that this reversal of the deterioration, as far as it had gotten, that was impossible. It could only be regarded as miraculous. This week, I emailed to my brother, Doug. I asked him how come he never told me that this chapter was in this book. But I also asked him, what about Simon's health now? Doug reports that Simon is doing fine. And in fact, he is still the lead driver for the ministry. Who was the beggar who prayed for Simon? Perhaps an angel? But where our attention must be drawn is to the one who healed Simon's foot, to God himself. Eric Metaxas points out in his book the Greek word for the word miracle means sign. And he writes this, he said, miracles are signs. And like all signs, they are never about themselves. They're about whatever they are pointing to. Miracles point to something beyond themselves, to God himself. Returning to the story in Joshua, the priests carrying the ark stood in the middle of the dry riverbed while the people crossed over. And God instructed Joshua to have one man from each tribe pick up a large rock from where the priests were standing, there in the middle of the riverbed, carry those 12 rocks to Gilgal where they would be camping that night. Reading from Joshua chapter 4, verse 19. It was the 10th day of the first month of the year when Israel crossed the Jordan River. They set up camp at Gilgal, which was east of the land controlled by Jericho. Verse 20, the men who had carried the 12 rocks from the Jordan brought them to Joshua, and they made them into a monument. And Joshua told the people, years from now, your children will ask you why these rocks are here. Tell them, the Lord our God dried up the Jordan River so we could walk across. He did the same thing here for us that he did for our people at the Red Sea. Verse 24, because he wants everyone on earth to know how powerful he is, and he wants us to worship only him. The whole point of miracles is to make us want to worship God alone. There's a verse in the Psalms. I will lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth.
My help comes from you. You're right here pulling me through. You carry my weakness, my sickness, my brokenness all on your shoulders, your shoulders. My help comes from you. You are my rest, my rescue. No, I don't have to see to believe that you're lifting me up on your shoulders, your shoulders.
Eric Metaxas writes this. He says, if God could speak the universe into existence, could he not afterwards speak into that existence? In John's Gospel, chapter 11, we read that a dear friend of Jesus named Lazarus was sick. And John makes the point of telling us that Jesus loved Lazarus and his two sisters, Martha and Mary. Nevertheless, even though he could have gone sooner, he didn't. He didn't go immediately. And so by the time Jesus arrived at their home, Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Hearing that Jesus had arrived, Martha went out to meet him. "Lord," Martha said, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died." Jesus answered and he said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into the world." At this point in the story, Jesus is still outside the village. And next, Mary, Lazarus's other sister, runs out to meet Jesus. And she kneels at Jesus' feet and she repeats word for word exactly what Martha had also said. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." And she's crying as those who are with her are also crying. "Where have you laid him?" Jesus asks. And at this point, we're told that Jesus also wept. The people around Mary saw Jesus weeping and they said, "See how he loved them." But others said, "He can heal the blind. Why didn't he save Lazarus from dying? If he could work miracles for others, why not for someone he loved?" Jesus tells them to take the stone away from the entrance. "But Lord," says Martha, "by now, there'll be a terrible smell. He's been dead for 4 days." Jesus replies to Martha, "Didn't I tell you that if you had faith, you would see the glory of God?" They roll the stone away, and Jesus looks up and he prays. "Father, I thank you for answering my prayer. I know that you always answer my prayers. But I said this so that the people here would believe that you sent me." And Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." Wrapped in strips of burial cloth, Lazarus comes out. And John goes on to tell us that as a result of this miracle, many believed in Jesus. Eric Metaxas writes this in this book, Miracles. He says, "Can we believe that this dear soul who loved his friends and who wept when they wept is the same one who created the moon and the sun and the stars? Jesus declares that he is the resurrection and the life. And then he demonstrates it by raising a 4-day-old corpse to breathing, walking, conscious life. In raising Lazarus from the dead, Jesus wanted all to see that the thing that it seems no one had yet seen, that he was God, the very author of life. And once we can fathom this, we not only think of Jesus differently, we think of life differently as well. The painting that you see in the upper left-hand side, it shows Lazarus just after he has been raised from the dead. It's one of the few paintings that has been done by Vincent van Gogh on a biblical theme. The painting itself, as you can see, is based on the etching below it, which was done by Rembrandt. Van Gogh's brother sent that etching by Rembrandt to Van Gogh. Van Gogh was in a mental hospital at the time. And it's said that the face of Lazarus is Van Gogh's self-portrait. Do you see yourself in the story? God says to you, if you will have faith, you will see the glory of God. I have my reasons, says God, for why you must wait. Wait and see the glory of God. There's one particular scene from the movie, 12 Years a Slave, in which a group of slaves is standing around the graveside of a fellow laborer who's died from exhaustion from picking cotton. And they're singing the gospel hymn, Roll, Jordan, Roll. It was originally written by Charles Wesley in the 1700s and became popular in America in the 1800s. Now, standing among the slaves is Solomon Northrop. Solomon Northrop, it's a true story. He was a New York State-born, free, African-American man who was kidnapped and sold into slavery in 1841. The movie is based on his life. He worked on plantations in the state of Louisiana for 12 years before he was finally released. The movie depicts Northrop standing among this group of slaves. They're singing, Roll, Jordan, Roll. There is supposed to be a particular significance to this scene. As they sing, he first resists to sing, and then he finally joins in. And as he does so, his voice becomes stronger. And you can see it in his face. And what this scene is meant to show is his determination at this point, not just to survive, but to live.
Went down to the River Jordan, where John baptized three. When I walked the devil in hell, says Johnny baptized me. I say, roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year, Jordan, roll. Well, some say John was a Baptist. Some say John was a Jew. But I say John was a preacher, cause my Bible says so too. I say, roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year when Jordan roll. Hallelujah. Roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year when Jordan roll. Hallelujah. Roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year when Jordan roll.
Everybody say, roll,
Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year when Jordan roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year when Jordan roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. Roll, Jordan, roll. My soul arise in heaven, Lord, for the year when Jordan roll.
The Jordan River is what stands between us and the Promised Land. It is that obstacle in our way. It is what crossing would give us release from pain and suffering. And sometimes we stand at the water's edge, and we're waiting, and we're praying for those rushing waters to stop, so we can cross over. But the Jordan just keeps rolling on. We're waiting and we're praying for a miracle. Never seems to happen. Can it be writes Eric Metaxas, that God allows us to go through times, go through things, specifically so that we have an opportunity to trust Him and then to see Him do something that we wouldn't have expected. Something beautiful and extraordinary that wouldn't have been possible if we had our prayers answered when and how we wanted them to be answered. If this is true, wouldn't it follow that any difficulty we encounter is an opportunity to trust God, to see how He might bring something glorious out of our trial? Wouldn't it also follow that if we did not look to God in our difficulty, we would be missing the opportunity to see Him do something more wonderful than merely taking away the difficulty? Or perhaps it tells us that if we really know who God is, we will want to trust Him. And we will allow Him to bring us into difficulties or suffering, knowing that if we let Him, He will use these things to bless us and to do something beautiful that wouldn't have been possible otherwise. So those who have faith in the God of the Bible can know that even if we don't get the miracle we are praying for, we can relax and trust that God is nonetheless leading us towards something through whatever it is we are enduring. So we sing, "Roll, Jordan, roll." Hallelujah. Roll, Jordan, roll. Viktor Frankl, who endured the death camps of Nazi Germany, in his famous book, Man's Search for Meaning, said this: "In some ways, suffering ceases to be suffering at the moment it finds a meaning, such as the meaning of sacrifice. Those who have a why to live can bear with almost any how." Edwin Tumbu, the Singaporean poet, wrote a poem entitled Lazarus. It's written from the perspective of Lazarus after having been brought back to life. The first three lines of this poem read as follows: "You know the Lord restored my breath, but why me? The shock still scares. I am a little miracle, entirely His, reborn to show His glory, irrefutable for all to see." Can you say that? I am a little miracle, entirely His, reborn to show His glory, irrefutable for all to see. Are you just surviving life? Are you just getting by? Or are you living out God's purpose for your life? Have you experienced the miracle of being reborn into newness of life, living for God, living for the glory of God, finding meaning through living out God's purpose for your life? Trusting with that same confidence that Paul expresses in Romans 8:28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose. Eric Metaxas tells how his life changed literally overnight He shares how God miraculously spoke to him.
But I remember going to college and really thinking, I don't know what I believe. I have no clue. And I'm so open-minded that in an environment like Yale, particularly, it's a very secular environment. You know, by the time I graduated, I was really absolutely at sea. I had no idea what I believed or who I was. It got tough. It was very unpleasant. I was 24, moved back in with my folks. And, you know, my European immigrant parents were not thinking, oh, Eric wants to be a poet and a writer, and, you know, he's finding himself. And their attitude is, you should, like, find yourself a job. The only thing I could do to make a buck was I got a job as a proofreader at Union Carbide. It was an awful, awful time. I mean, it was to work in a corporate environment as somebody who thinks of himself as a humorist and a poet, and it was just horrible. In the middle of this agony, I met a guy. He was a graphic designer at Union Carbide, a little bit older than I was. He had a wife and a kid, and he sort of befriended me, and we just hang out and talk, and he clearly was serious about his Christian faith. For a long time, that made me uncomfortable because I'd been trained at Yale. You know, we avoid people like this. These are weird people. I remember this guy saying to me, Eric, you know, you should pray that God would reveal himself to you. I remember thinking, that makes absolutely no sense, because if I don't even know if God's there, how am I going to pray to him? I don't even know if he exists. But if you're in enough pain, you'll do stupid stuff. So I'd be like jogging, and in my pain, I would just pray, God, if you're there, I need a sign. You know, I'm just trapped. I'm trapped in my own mind, in my own way of seeing the world. There's just no way out. Then my uncle Tykes, he had a stroke. I remember this friend of mine, Ed Tuttle, this graphic designer, said to me that some of his folks at his church were praying for my uncle. And I'll never forget that. I was blown away by the kindness of this. I said, wow, that's kind of amazing that you don't even know my uncle, and you and people in your church are praying for my uncle. And I also was blown away by the intellectual concept that you're praying to this God that you think can heal people. So it's not just, you know, some vague energy force. You believe there's this God who cares. And I wasn't persuaded that this is real, but I was just moved by the concept of it. And then one day that week, he asked me, would you like to pray for your uncle? And I said, yeah. You know, it's like, up till then I was like, no, I don't want to pray, I don't want to do anything weird, go to church or do Bible study. But my uncle's sick, let's go pray. And so he takes me into this, you know, bleak, fluorescent lit conference room at Union Carbide, just awful. And we go in there and close the door, and he prays. And I close my eyes. I had never done this before, ever. Now imagine, I grew up in the church. I was an altar boy. Nobody, like, prays like that. My uncle passed away, but I remember at the funeral, the priest asked me if I would read the Psalms. It was just kind of this thing. And I thought, yeah, I want to do that. Like, something was engaged, basically, for the first time. And right around this time, I had a dream. It was right around my 25th birthday, so 25 years ago, I had a dream. And that dream changed everything. It was a life-changing, mind-blowing dream. In the dream, I'm standing on Lake Candlewood in Danbury, Connecticut. It's winter. I'm standing on the ice. I'm ice fishing with my buddy John and his dad. It's one of those glorious winter days where the sun is bright. The sky is incredibly blue. There's white snow and ice. And we're standing there, and I look down into the hole where we were fishing, and there's a fish sticking its snout out of the hole. Now, if you ice fish, you may know that that never happens. And I reach down, and I pick it up, and I hold it up. And in the dream, the light from the light from the sun was so bright, and it shone on the side of this fish in a way that it made it look not bronze, but actually golden, like it was made of gold. And then suddenly in the dream, I realized that, no, it's not looking gold. It's not just appearing to be gold. It's actually golden. I'm holding up a living golden fish. The way I look at the dream in retrospect is that God was speaking to me with what I call the secret vocabulary of my heart. This dream would have meant nothing to anyone else. It would have been just bizarre. In my 20s, after college, I finally came up with what I thought was a suitable answer to the meaning of the universe. I came up with this idea that, okay, it's kind of like a literary image. You have a frozen lake, and the ice on the lake represents the conscious mind, and the water beneath the ice represents the unconscious mind or the collective unconscious. And so that's Jung's idea of God, or this kind of Eastern God force. And so the goal of life and of all religions is basically the same. Okay, it's to drill through the ice, the conscious mind, to reach the collective unconscious. This was this kind of idea that I had come up with. So when I had the dream, obviously, it had some believable resonance. And so I'm holding this fish, and I realized in the dream, like it's just like these paragraphs just drop into my head, boom, boom, like I know God has just one-upped me with my own symbol system. I, in the dream, am aware, looking at this golden fish like it's out of a fairy tale, that God has just said to me without a word, Eric, you wanted to touch water. You wanted to touch inert water. This collective unconscious, this Eastern idea of this God force, but I have something else for you. I have my son, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, your Savior. This was huge. In fact, I remember specifically, and this has meaning here, that when we would see the fish on the back of the car, the chrome fish, they started popping up in the 70s, my father got really excited about telling me that this is a Greek word. That the Greek word for fish is ichthys, and that's an acronym, Jesus Christos Theos Imon Sotir, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, our Savior, and that's where the Christians came up with the fish symbol. So in the dream, I instantly knew all this came together and just blew my mind. You know, it was transcendent. I went to work the next day, and I told my friend, Ed Tuttle, I said, I had this dream, and he says, well, what do you think that means? And I said, well, it means I've accepted Jesus. And I never, never would have said those words. I would have cringed to say those words. In fact, I would have cringed if anybody else said those words. I cringed when people said stuff like that. I just thought, ugh. But I mean, what can I tell you? I mean, it was absolutely mind-blowing. People have said faith is a leap in the dark. Let's switch the cliches. Faith is a leap into the light. If it's not true, I don't want to believe it. If it's just kind of helping me a little bit, but it's not ultimately true, then it's what are you believing in? I remember the guy who I was talking to, my graphic designer friend Ed Tuttle, shared with me a scripture before I had become a Christian. And it was that famous scripture from Jeremiah, that where God says, I know the plans I have for you. Plans not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. There is no doubt in retrospect that God is real. And I wish I had known that a lot sooner. To think that I could grow up in a church and go to one of the finest universities and never encounter any incredible witness of this kind of faith, that says a lot about the culture we live in. I mean, God didn't just create us. He invented the idea of us, and he invented every single one of us. He knows us so intimately, so you cannot ever really know who you are apart from him. To know that my life is not a mistake, to know that my life is not meaningless, to really know, that's freedom. That's real freedom. My name is Eric Metaxas, and I am Second.
Eric gave this testimony at a university, and there were about 2,000 people in the auditorium. But early the next morning, he got an email. It's from one of the students that had been there and heard the testimony. And the student wrote and said that when he heard it, He wasn't impressed at all. In fact, he felt it was rather pretentious. And he said that as he walked out of the auditorium, he sarcastically joked with his friends, "Yeah, maybe God will speak to me in a dream tonight." The student went on to say that night, God did speak to him in a dream. And that's why he was emailing Eric to tell him. He was from England. He was a first-year student at the university. He had lost his mother to suicide 3 months before. He wasn't a Christian. And he believed God was speaking to him and telling him that he needed to accept Jesus so that he could bring peace and comfort to his stepfather and his 11-year-old stepbrother who were hurting badly. Eric concluded by saying that he had been in touch with a student and he had kept in touch with a student, was happy to report that he is thriving in his newfound faith. My dad taught mathematics at a local college. His favorite hobby was building. He turned the attic of our home into a second floor with two bedrooms, one for me and one for my brother. And he turned our basement into a meeting room for the university's Chinese Christian Fellowship, SUNY Buffalo. They met in our home every Friday evening for several years. Every morning before he would head off to work, you could see him in his study, reading his Bible and having a time of prayer. And my dad loved the Lord and he loved us. I have many good memories of my dad. He had a good tenor's voice. He enjoyed singing for church, and I would accompany him on the piano. That's the two of us that you hear. But I also remember my dad often feeling sick and experiencing stomach trouble. He died of stomach cancer the year I graduated from high school. He was 49 years old. In fact, he had had surgery to remove a portion of his stomach 18 years before. Doctors discovered his cancer 18 years before he actually died. After that first surgery, the doctors told my mom, and they only told my mom, they didn't tell my father, that he had just weeks to live. She didn't tell my dad, and she didn't tell anyone else. So she carried this knowledge with her all those 18 years. Alone in that knowledge, while all the time continuing in faith, trusting the Lord to give my dad however long to live. It was during those 18 years that I was born. So you see, I am a little miracle too. If my dad had died when the doctors expected him to, I wouldn't be here. But God kept my dad all those 18 years. 18 years later, 1972, in the months that were leading up to his death, as the cancer returned and it spread, and my dad went through more surgery and chemotherapy, and as he went through all of this, his favorite verse was Psalm 34:19. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Now, I always remember what my dad said about this verse. God doesn't promise no difficulties. Doesn't promise that we won't experience pain and affliction. In fact, the psalmist goes so far as to say that the righteous can expect many afflictions. But what God does promise is that in his way and in his time, he will deliver us out of them. Created this world, you are all powerful. You know the afflictions that we have. And Lord, we stand there and help us by faith to come to the water's edge, praying and asking, trusting, knowing that you will work all things together for good. And we trust you. Our confidence is in you. We have seen you work. We have seen your power. Lord, help our faith. We are so quick to forget. We are so easy to despair. But Heavenly Father, we pray that you would come and fill our hearts right now. And by your Spirit, whatever are the afflictions and whatever are the obstacles that we face, that you would come, and that in your will and in your time and in your way, you would deliver us. We pray this in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.